My name is Michael Monstein. I'm a father of two children, and I was diagnosed with cancer out of the blue. 2 weeks later, my life looked radically different and has never been the same since.
Even two rounds of chemotherapy couldn't treat Michael's aggressive cancer.
If left untreated, I would die in 2 or 3 months at best. So it's incredibly serious.
His last hope is a gene therapy with cancer-killing cells, such as Kymriah from Novartis, with a price tag of 370,000 Swiss francs. And Kymriah is just the beginning.
A new drug, Luxturna, was injected into his eye. $850,000. Zolgensma, it's now the most expensive drug on earth, with a price tag of $2.1 million.
How willing is society to bear the costs? And when do you let someone die to save money?
How are these prices calculated?
Of course, pharmaceutical companies sound the market to determine what can they get out of it and where the limit is.
Would health insurance companies pay these record prices?
370,000 francs is a lot of money and we can't afford it.
What can you do?
It's tricky. It's hard to tell what the future has in store.
We're going to get this cancer.
Let's hope so.
Michael Monstein has a rare and aggressive form of lymph node cancer. His crooked mouth also comes from the disease. His last hope is Kymriah, a completely new treatment just approved last fall. Samples are taken of the patient's own immune cells, and these are sent to a Novartis laboratory in the U.S. There, the cells are genetically modified and reprogrammed into cancer-killing cells. After being multiplied and frozen, these cells are sent back to Switzerland. The patient receives the killer cells in one single infusion with a price tag of 370,000 Swiss francs, according to the Novartis catalog. It remains unclear whether the health insurance companies will pay for Kymriah. They have joined together to negotiate a discount.
I'm Martina Weiss, and I work for the insurer Heysana, where I negotiate contracts with the pharmaceutical industry. We're currently negotiating the price of Kymriah with Novartis.
The price is too much, she says, partly because it is unclear what long-term effects Kymriah will have and whether the cancer will return.
It isn't quite clear to us how the price came about. We didn't receive any cost breakdown and don't know why the price is so high.
Do pharma companies provide that?
There's no formula as to how the price breaks down. I've never seen one. I think they try to start with as high a price as possible because in the end it always gets negotiated down. The first price they set is just a starting point. It's a real problem. And if you ask me, I couldn't tell you what we can do about it.
They discussed whether health insurers should pay only in the event of success. But what is success when it comes to cancer? There's no solution in sight, and for the time being, every insurer is deciding for themselves. Michael Monstein's low-cost insurer, Atupri, refuses to pay for Kymriah. The benefits are not clear enough, they say.
To be honest, I was furious, because this stinks of incompetence. In the end, it's like the Wild West. Those who can afford treatment are the ones who get a chance to have it. And for others, it's not clear whether they can.
It's two-tier healthcare.
Yes.
Mikhail's relatives want to fund the treatment themselves, but the hospital is demanding half a million francs as security. After a Kymriah infusion, some patients' reactions require transfer to the intensive care unit.
Gabi is kindly willing to give a 50,000 franc advance on her inheritance.
I'm also getting an advance on an inheritance. When my brothers bought their houses, they got their share, and I hadn't needed it so far. But now I'd like to use it for this.
It really touched me that a lot of people I know are ready to give 10,000 francs if it'll help, saying they know it isn't much. There are a lot of kind people like that, and it really touches me. Because everyone realizes that in the worst-case scenario, the money will simply be gone. And in the very worst case, it won't even have done any good.
According to Novartis, 1.5 years after treatment, 40% of patients like Mikhail Monstein still have cancer. That's a start, but could it be better?
Of course, but the drug I'm currently on had a 20% chance of success. There were days when I thought, that's it, it's over. I could only hope my final hours would go quickly. I didn't want my family to have to watch forever and for me to be in never-ending pain. I didn't want to lie around like a vegetable on drugs.
About a dozen cancer patients cannot be treated due to the price dispute. Critics might claim the health insurers are at fault, with terminally ill patients running out of time and dying while negotiations lag on with Novartis.
But that's not the case. We all share the responsibility because we have yet to find a solution to this all-around less than ideal situation.
Michael Monstein's family has scraped together half a million francs. He is the first lymphatic cancer patient in Switzerland to receive Kymriah.
Guten Morgen.
Michael has immune cells taken from him that will be shipped by plane to the U.S., where they will be converted into cancer-killing cells, referred to as CAR T cells. Will the treatment work? Michael's cancer is growing, so every day counts.
It takes a while for the cells to be produced. In a best-case scenario, it will be 4 weeks. But it may take a little longer since so many products are sent in. To ensure the funds are available, Zuger Kantonalbank is prepared to issue a bank guarantee. And we're supposed to deposit everything into a special escrow account.
We'll make sure it's not touched, but this way we can proceed with treatment.
May I feel your lymph nodes?
Kymriah was approved through clinical trials funded by Novartis.
Here, I can feel at least two.
Experts criticize the fact that the effect of Kymriah has been tested on less than 100 patients worldwide. The follow-up period was less than 2 years, and Kymriah was not compared to an existing treatment, so the long-term effects remain unknown. This criticism generally holds true for other trials on rare diseases. But naturally, patients want the treatment as soon as possible. And the companies present the study results as positively as they can, says Antonia Müller.
This is the case everywhere, and it's intuitive, although there have also been studies with CAR T cells that had to be aborted because test subjects were dying and there were too many side effects.
Isn't that crazy?
Yes, but we're also talking about patients who would otherwise die, along with all their concomitant diseases. The world has gotten impatient, and our patients have too. We're not just going to say to them, let's wait 5 years. That's the problem.
The trial with these deaths didn't concern Novartis, which conducted follow-up studies on safety and efficacy. What do you say about Novartis's price?
I find the prices in general to be staggering in many areas, and not just those of Novartis. And these prices are completely non-transparent to patients and to us doctors. But there must be someone enabling all of this to go on, because there are vested interests. There are reasons why they want to be on the company's good side.
Es gibt bestimmte Interessen, die dahinter stecken, warum man sich mit den Firmen gut stellen möchte.
Why?
Standorte.
Because they could also produce in India or China.
Oder in China produzieren könnten.
So it means jobs in Basel.
Arbeitsplätze, na ja.
It's the jobs, of course. And if you look at Switzerland, for example, it doesn't have much industry, but it does boast a few of the world's most important pharmaceutical companies.
At Novartis's plant in the town of Stein in Aargau, Switzerland, we meet with the head of cell and gene therapy in Europe, Emanuela Ostuni.
How are you?
So this will be, this will be a key site for us.
They avoid talking about numbers here, but can Swiss patients expect a price discount if the transport costs to the US are eliminated? No, says Mr. Ostuni, because the production site doesn't affect the price. It is the value of gene therapy that is relevant, meaning a prolonged life. This is a paradigm shift, because the pharmaceutical industry used to justify its prices with high research costs. The principle of value-based prices is wrong, health insurers say, because a human life is ultimately priceless. And they estimate that premiums will rise by more than 10% over 10 years due to the cost of medicines.
And you're not afraid that the healthcare system could break if you continue like this?
No, I'm not afraid. I think we can find the solutions. We are open to take risks.
For discounts.
We're open to take risks with our stakeholders to make sure that we can bring the therapies to the patient.
The pharmaceutical industry calls this risk sharing, with those insured bearing part of the risk, including the risk for Kymriah, which was not even invented by Novartis. These cancer-killing cells trace their origins back to the University of Pennsylvania. And this is far from an isolated case, with more than 60% of newly approved drugs in the US not stemming from pharmaceutical companies.
I'm Carl June. I'm a professor at the University of Pennsylvania. My team invented Kymriah in 2004. I'm 65 years old, but I began working on this in 1992.
Carl June was named one of the world's 100 most influential people by Time magazine in 2018.
We first actually tested this in patients who had HIV infection, because they had lost, due to the virus, many of their own T cells. And 2 years later, my wife died of ovarian cancer in 2001. And so that really made me move from HIV and to do really all cancer work.
At the time, however, he did not receive a dollar from the pharmaceutical industry because the treatment initially only worked on mice, but not humans.
Okay. What we know for sure is that funding essentially was essential to make a new industry. So to have philanthropy and then government support.
It was millions, right?
It was millions. It was probably $20 million. I mean, I think for sure $20 million were invested between when I came to University of Pennsylvania in 1999 until Novartis and the alliance we made in 2012.
But the riskiest part was paid by the government.
Yes, all the initial research that showed this new concept of a CAR T cell could work was done in academic laboratories.
In 2010 came the breakthrough in the cancer patient Douglas Olson. However, it was the news of 7-year-old Emily Whitehead that spread around the world. Kimraya saved the young leukemia patient's life, and even 7 years after the infusion, she remained cancer-free. The treatment is more effective in children than adults.
We had hundreds of calls from venture capitalists wanting to start new companies, and fortunately we had Novartis call us about wanting to commercialize this.
Inventing a drug is one thing, says Novartis, but putting the research into practical use through a market launch is costly and time-consuming. Insiders say Novartis paid the university about $225 million for the exclusive right to sell Kimraya. And Novartis is paying the university about 5% of the sales price for each infusion. The group has no comment on this.
The healthcare industry is not transparent, and it's not been designed for the benefit directly of the patient and transparency. Our most recent estimates are around $55,000 just to make the CAR T cell. That's our cost per patient and with no profit.
So the actual cost is almost 7 times cheaper. The university, however, had only done small-scale trials with Kimraya, while Novartis had to fund worldwide studies to attain market approval and build centers to produce the treatment. Michael Monstein is still waiting for his cancer-killing cells from the U.S. when suddenly a message comes from Novartis. The group will give him Kimraya for free.
We were filled with joy and very relieved. There was a lot of money at stake.
What about other Kimraya patients?
I don't know Novartis's plans.
Ethically, it's a delicate question as to whom Novartis gives free treatment.
Yes, of course.
The first 2 Swiss patients are being given Kimraya for free because negotiations with healthcare insurers are taking so long, Novartis explains. Michael Monstein, a father of 2 children, will ultimately lose the race against time. Novartis USA informs him that his cancer-killing cells have not managed to multiply well enough to produce Kimraya. 19 days later, he dies.
My name is Paul Kloetken. I've been in the pharmaceutical industry for 30 years. My last position was as president and chief executive officer of a company. I am retired now, and over the last 5 years, I have been dealing with an incurable cancer. So Karen, what I'd like to show you is all the medications that I have to take in a day. This being the most important one, this is my anti-cancer drug. This product, I have to take one of these capsules per day. The cost of those is $750 each. And interestingly enough, they only cost $1 each to manufacture.
What do you think about the price of 370,000 Swiss francs for Kimraya?
It's ridiculous, Karen. It should never happen. This is a product that was developed at the expense of the US taxpayer.
Did you have a different view when you were still a pharma manager than you have now on your industry?
The answer is yes, Karen. And for two reasons. First, I was not a patient. I've been part of the system. My family's been a beneficiary of that system. I really didn't know any better at the time. You know, you go to work and you get a perspective, which is the company perspective. And what you learn as you get older is your perspective becomes much wider.
Paul Kloetgen is the former CEO of a company acquired by Novartis in 2002. He says Novartis also benefited from a 50% discount on the cost of its trials with Kymriah. This was the US's way of incentivizing research on rare diseases.
It's people like myself who actually have funded the development program or half the development program of Kymriah, and what we get in return is basically a punch in the teeth from Novartis.
He created a price model for Kymriah based on Novartis's claims that it had invested over 1 billion euros by the time the treatment was approved.
I calculated a fair price, Karen, of $200,000 per infusion in 2019, using the assumption that Novartis would generate a total of 1,700 patient infusions.
Out of 14,000 potentially.
As time goes on, we can actually drop that price.
It can be reduced to about half of 370,000 francs. The fair price is calculated in such a way that Novartis achieves an average operating profit of 20.7%. The research costs averaging at 17.3% are also included in this calculation. The health insurer association, Santé Suisse, is also demanding a price of 200,000 francs for Kymriah.
I've looked at the document you sent me. The document is full of incorrect information.
Then give me the correct information.
I cannot give you that.
And why
I cannot not? I cannot comment on it because it is not our data. It is not our document.
The criticism on the pharma, not just Novartis, but on the pharma's intransparency is growing worldwide. We hear it at WHO. We hear it with the health insurers, with the public, because the public is the payer. Are you afraid that this will damage the image of Novartis?
No, I'm not afraid of damage to Novartis. What you mentioned in transparency is required across the system, not just from one party.
Our government is asking for transparency because we have a transparent list for prices. I think it's the opposite.
It can be discussed in a broader group. I think it's a different conversation.
Seventy-one-year-old Kurt Benninger from Bern also has lymph node cancer. And he says if he has the strength, he goes out with his dogs. Because of the price dispute, he has had to wait 3 months for the health insurer to decide whether to pay for Kymriah. Could you afford it if the health insurance didn't pay?
If I were 100% sure it would work, I would sell my house, but I can't. If it doesn't work, my wife will be left with nothing. That's out of the question.
If the company didn't pay for you, you wouldn't do it?
No, it's too risky.
Because the low chance of being cured. Each year, around 110 cancer patients in Switzerland who have undergone all other treatments to no avail receive Kymriah. And the 64-year-old teacher Anton Schlösser in Bündnerland is one of them. The question is, what is a human life worth? To put it bluntly, you're over 60. If a young person asks, how much longer do you have left? Is it even worth it when curing your illness is a best-case scenario? Does it hurt to hear that kind of question?
No, but I've also met young people in the hospital who are in greater need, when you look at it that way. I've lived a decent life, and it's been nice so far.
I almost feel ashamed, even though I didn't set the price. You feel very uncomfortable and so guilty. But it's the only chance he has left. Of course you're not going to say no.
Do you feel guilty?
Not really. I was in good health for a long time and paid premiums for decades, yet never really needed anything. This came as a surprise.
His health insurance is also paying for Kimraya. The price negotiations between the insurers and Novartis took 4 months, with the price being haggled up and down like at a bazaar. Some insurers threw in the towel, while others came to an agreement with Novartis. Insiders say insurers wanted a 45% discount on Kimraya for treating lymphatic cancer, which was too much for Novartis. They instead agreed to a 20 to 30% discount, depending on Kimraya's success rate, meaning about 250,000 to 300,000 francs. But no one is willing to talk about it. The agreement, after all, is confidential. In fact, it is so shrouded in secrecy that health insurers, such as Concordia, which were not in on the deal, will not even find out their discount until they have signed the contract.
I think it's scandalous. This is the first time I know of for us to conclude a contract where we don't even know the price. That's unheard of in Swiss healthcare, where prices and contract clauses are normally transparent. You can usually check what you have to pay for hospital treatment, and cost transparency is very important in healthcare. Otherwise, we subjugate ourselves to the big corporations.
Kurt Benninger has to have another cell sample taken. Because Novartis didn't manage to produce the cancer-killing cells in the U.S., as they did for Michael Monstein.
Of course, it doesn't feel good. Things were looking up at first, but then there weren't enough cells.
In the approval study for Kimraya, one-third of patients could not be treated at all, either because the cancer-killing cells couldn't be produced, the patient's illness had progressed too far, or they had died waiting, like Michael Monstein. Anton Schlösser receives good news from the U.S. His cancer-killing cells have been successfully produced and are on their way to Switzerland.
Then you get back these CAR T immune cells that are even stronger than normal immune cells. And when immune cells get into action, there are side effects. Patients may experience fever, circulatory problems, or even organ failure. Kidney failure, for instance, has been observed in about 20% of patients who then need a dialysis.
Dass tatsächlich Patienten an die Dialyse, also Blutwäsche, mussten.
Cancer-killing cells can heal patients and kill them. So those cells are the last hope for those who would otherwise die of the disease.
My name is Alfred Scheidegger, and I'm a risk capital investor. Here in San Francisco, I'm attending the world's biggest healthcare conference.
Alfred Scheidegger invests in small biotech companies developing new cancer drugs.
Have a good day.
Bye-bye.
His goal is to sell the small companies to pharmaceutical companies for a profit.
Super. How are you doing?
We're actually doing okay, Fred. I know it's painful to see the stock, but we're doing okay.
Alles gut, tschüss.
Mr. Scheidegger, what's going on here?
Yeah, das ist also.
It's like a marriage market. It's unbelievable. You run into all kinds of biotech companies, especially oncological ones, or pharmaceutical companies aiming to take over small companies later on, once they've provided proof that their cancer drug is effective in humans, like we're doing.
...60% of new drugs are not developed by pharmaceutical companies, but by small biotech companies. They need a lot of money for studies with patients. And this money comes from investors like Alfred Scheidegger and Markus Hosang. Scheidegger's company often invests during the early stages of research, but the pharmaceutical industry pays the most when a biotech company is about to launch a new drug on the market.
Novartis is buying the U.S. company AveXis. The price tag, nearly $9 billion.
Gilead Sciences agreed to buy Kite Pharma for almost $12 billion.
Novartis is now demanding a record price of $2.1 million for AveXis treatment.
There are calculations involved that have an impact on the price. You have to gain back your investment, and of course, that's part of the market price in the end.
With Kymriah, Novartis managed to avoid dealing with the biotech companies or investors by signing a contract directly with the university, saving them billions. For patient Kurt Benninger at Inselspital Hospital, Kymriah is able to be successfully produced on the second try. ...43 milliliters cost 370,000 francs.
This is a discussion that I frankly do not want to get into now at a patient's bedside.
I've still got a life to live. I feel like that can't be it.
You have high hopes it will work? Anton Schlosser received his infusion 2 days earlier.
How are you doing?
Fine.
Tired, right?
I fall asleep even if I want to watch something.
Can you tell if the Kymriah is working?
It's too early. We hope so, of course, but we can't tell. We have high expectations, of course. Oh, excuse me for a moment.
A government representative on the phone informs her of new problems with Kymriah. Since it is considered a hospital treatment, the cantons have to cover 55% of the costs.
No, we're starting that process in parallel. It's a vicious circle, because the health insurance only covers the costs if the cantonal government also agrees to give its part. Each of them says they'll only do it if the other has already agreed.
We're meeting with Jenny Lee, an investment banker from Hong Kong, where she covers China.
China conducts the most trials on cancer-killing cells worldwide. And market observers say if the treatment is approved there, it will cost about $70,000.
Hi, Jenny.
Hi.
How are you doing?
Freddie, nice meeting you again.
We met last time in Hong Kong. It was great.
Jenny Lee says the Chinese government is putting pressure on pharmaceutical companies.
On the night of the 4th, then they have to lower their drugs to be approved for marketing.
They did.
Because what you gain instead will be a huge volume of the drug sales,
right? It's
the volume. If the pharmaceutical companies remain those high price, really the Chinese market cannot afford it. The Chinese patients or our insurance system. So it will be a loss-loss situation for all parties.
Yeah. Is this about profit or saving lives?
Pharma, also.
The existential justification of a private company is to generate profit.
And that comes before life.
You can't really ask that question.
Anton Schlosser's wife documents his treatment using a cell phone.
Are you sad?
No.
Depressed?
No.
Agitated?
No.
In the first days, he has fever and chills, so only minor side effects. It's the same story at Inselspital with Kurt Benninger coming down with a fever, but otherwise he feels fine. Do you feel like it's doing any good?
I can't say. We don't know yet.
Hello, I'm Marcus.
Sean Carbonell.
Sean, nice meeting you.
This biotech company is researching in the booming field of medicines for rare diseases, referred to as orphan drugs, just like Kymriah.
When you say salutation, so how's your
We are strategically focusing on orphan designation and pediatric indications.
That's cool.
In the U.S. and EU, orphan drugs receive exclusive marketing rights, with similar products from competitors excluded from approval for up to 10 years.
The law is built to incentivize research, because once you obtain approval, you enjoy a sort of exclusivity for several years. A competitor can't just launch on the market. That's exclusivity.
In the US, the Orphan Drug Act was enacted almost 40 years ago. Today, the politician who initiated it laments that some pharmaceutical companies are exploiting their monopoly to increase their profits. The topic of orphan drugs and market exclusivity also reached Switzerland a few years ago.
Ladies and gentlemen, pursuant to council regulations, before engaging in the debate on this topic, I hereby disclose my vested interests. I am the president of Intergenerica, the Swiss Association of Generic Drug and Biosimilar Manufacturers. In order to promote the development of medicines for rare diseases, pharmaceutical companies should enjoy market exclusivity for 10 years for orphan drugs. During this period, no other medicinal product should be approved for the same therapeutic indication unless it is proven to be safer or more effective.
The point is, pharmaceutical companies are not social institutions, and they only conduct research when they expect a profit. In order for new drugs for rare diseases to be introduced at all, it takes a monopoly, and this is achieved through market exclusivity.
When Sebastian Frehner was voted into parliament, he gave an access badge to Novartis lobbyist at the time, while Novartis and Roche donated nearly 900,000 Swiss francs to the middle class parties last year.
At the end of the debate, it became clear to us it was not the patients who had gained anything through this revision of the law on therapeutic products. Instead, the main changes had been about whose coffers could be filled up even more. Throughout the Commission's deliberations, and still here today, I feel like I, and perhaps others here too, have only been aware of a fraction of all the lobbying going on here in the background. And that had consequences. I received a reprimand from Pascal Brennissen, then the head of Novartis Switzerland.
And what did he say?
He emailed Beat Jans and me because he wanted to meet with us and discuss our stance. He claimed we were not being pharmaceutical friendly in our lawmaking work. I thought it was outrageous for him to interfere with my parliamentary work.
Had that ever happened before?
I never experienced that previously or again.
The debate went on for 2 years, and the National Council voted in favor of market exclusivity twice, but the Council of States opposed it. The monopoly didn't pass, but instead a stripped-down measure protecting orphan drugs did. One month after the infusion with Kymriah, Anton Schlosser is thoroughly examined. Did Kymriah work? And has the cancer disappeared?
I'm first going to show you the old pictures. There was this lump here. There was the main mass in the fascial compartment. And of course, on your lower leg. Here's afterward. With just some slight activity. There's still some in the fascial compartment, but it's already receded a lot. I couldn't have expected things to go any better. The old tumor mass has completely disappeared without a trace of inflammation.
Can you tell if he's in remission or could the cancer come back again?
We don't have a crystal ball. We don't know. But it's a good start. You can never rule it out. But with Kymriah and treatment rates with CAR T cells, we still need more data.
Meanwhile, at Inselspital, Kurt Benninger's cancer also disappeared immediately after the treatment.
Of course, I'm glad I can get home. And I'm done wearing this mask.
Take care and enjoy life.
Have a good day, yeah?
His doctor doesn't want to give a prognosis. According to the Novartis study, it takes about 1 year to know which patients have overcome lymphatic cancer for good. More than half die. And it's not yet clear how the cancer-killing cells develop in the body in the long term. In this brave new world of healthcare, the cost of a chance at survival is exorbitant. Kymriah is just the beginning.